Fours and fives, which is quite appropriate, as I have four guests, or, you know, five if I include myself. On the one hand, here's Aisling B. No two ways about it, it's David Mitchell. Three cheers for Nish Kumar. Yay. And at sixes and sevens, Alan Davis. What are their buzzers for? Aisling goes...
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
David goes...
5, 5, 5.
Oh. I was ready to get into that.
I think that was someone singing 5.
OK, good. Nish goes...
5 bad boys with a power to rock you.
Yes. And Alan goes...
4.
Question one is about quadrupeds. Name a quadruped that can't swim.
My mum?
Is she often on all fours?
No, 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 Alan. Oh. Alan Davies.
Alan Davies.
If we could come away from any thoughts about Nish's mother being on all fours, I would appreciate it. So, quadrupeds.
Now, Sandy, I feel like this relies on everybody knowing what that word means.
So, quad...
4.
And ped...
L-O.
Feet. You had it, so quad...
4 feet. 4 feet.
4 feet, you totally knew it.
And your mother has 4 feet.
I am 4 feet.
Can you swim? Is that the answer?
So, we're more in the animal world, people. Mm. We're not in the Kumar household at all.
Okay. They all float, don't they?
Well, when they're dead.
Yes.
Yeah, they float to the surface eventually when all the stomach juices start to decompose. Yeah. They'll bob up then. But is that really swimming?
It's good to have you back, David. Cheerful Mitchell.
They float because of the air in their lungs. It's only when their lungs fill with water they won't float. So, but, unless you can't keep your breathing passages above the water.
You're right. What might not be able
an
to
an elephant.
Do that? Well.
Of all the animals, probably the most likely to be able to...
Inbuilt snorkel. Yeah.
Is it a blue whale? Sometimes it is.
It could so easily have been a blue whale had it had any feet at all. So the elephant is rather brilliantly evolved, in fact, to be able to swim, because it possibly that was a snorkel, the trunk.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
You know.
That's someone got excited in the pool.
So elephants can
giraffe.
Swim. Giraffe is exactly the right answer that we're looking for. As we know, nobody has ever seen a giraffe swim. But there were two academics called Darren Nish and Don Henderson, and they decided, by careful computer modelling, to test out whether a giraffe can swim. And they concluded that giraffes would float but not swim. And actually, if they did swim, they'd be particularly bad at it. So, look at this.
Aww.
So here's the problem, is that giraffes have these really heavy, bony heads. So if all four legs of a giraffe were to leave the bottom of the river, the giraffe's hips would float higher than the shoulders and they would float downwards. So now what's going to happen with the head?
Yeah.
It's going to go under the water. So it's got to crick its neck back like this. So a giraffe to be able to swim would have to be in this position. So, the conclusion by the scientists is giraffes would be very poor swimmers and that it might be assumed they would avoid this activity if at all possible.
Could it not do a backstroke?
I think that's worse, probably. So, now you're having to be like this.
Ooh. Oh, wow.
You like the look of that, Nish?
Goodness me. Listen, if you've got a long neck, use it. It looks like me when I was a teenager.
The other creatures that have difficulty swimming are apes. How do they know apes have difficulty swimming?
Planet of the Apes films.
is one way. You never see them swimming.
Never see them swimming, Planet of the Apes.
Scientists were not sure if apes could swim, so they just dropped them in water. There was a guy called William Hornaday. He was the founder of Bronx Zoo. And he had an orangutan pet, which he called Old Man. And he just dropped it in some water. And he said, I watched him sink and go stiff. And there was an American animal behaviorist called Robert Yerkes. He similarly submerged young chimpanzees to see what happened. And he says, without exception, they struggled excitedly and quickly sank.
Oh, my God. That's
horrible. That's why you have moats around the enclosure with the apes, because they don't want to swim. What about camels? Anybody?
What are the humps going to do? Are they going to be buoyant? Probably.
Do you think camels are the descendants of giraffes who learned to swim because their lungs went up their back and their head started to go like this? They bring me on here for the big thoughts.
I really want the next series of Blue Planet to be presented by you. Maybe giraffes are just camels.
Yeah. It's very like David Attenborough was in the room. Some camels can. There's an Indian breed called Karai. It's known as the swimming camel of Gujarat. Hippos?
Definitely
swim.
Yeah,
great at it, aren't they?
Don't they more bounce than swim? Imagine that this is now a hippo. They go like this along the bottom of the river. And they can stay underwater for about 5 minutes.
They kill a lot of people, don't they, hippos?
Yeah.
Hippos are hungry.
No! Yeah, I'm going to give you the giraffe as a prize. I think that was... babies. Do babies have an innate ability to swim? What do we reckon?
No.
What's the audience think?
No.
Yes!
No, they drown.
Can I just say, do not do this. It is not true.
But a lot of people say it, though, don't they? A lot of people say, just chuck them in.
Yeah.
Drown! Because we're all evolved from fishes, and when you're a baby, you still sort of think you're a fish, and so it's all fine.
I think this Nirvana album had a lot of responsibility for this idea. It's not true. Babies do naturally hold their breath, but do not put them in the water. They do not have an innate ability. Giraffes would find swimming a pain in the neck, but... are elephants any good at drawing?
Yeah, there was that elephant who could paint.
Yes.
Is that him?
That's the one. Yeah, yeah, he's shy.
Yeah. Well, actually, that is an elephant with a paintbrush stuck up its nose.
There's an art gallery in Thailand that features a permanent display of paintings by elephants, but this is actually about another sense of drawing.
Is it pulling along?
It is pulling along, exactly right. It's pulling along a chariot. A Roman general's triumph involved his riding in a quadriga. So a quadriga, anybody know what a quadriga is?
Four-wheeled chariot, one elephant.
Okay, so it's four creatures pulling a quadriga. So usually it was four horses and they would pull them through a triumphal gate, an archway of some kind. So Pompey the Great's first triumph, 79 BC, he thought, totally gonna overshadow everybody. I'm going to have four elephants to pull my quadriga to reflect the fact that his victory was in Africa. He got to a gate. What was the problem?
Too wide.
Yeah, couldn't get through. He had the embarrassment of having to get down while they swapped the elephants over for horses.
They have one of those things, you know, when they say no lorries over a certain...
But the quadriga is an amazing... It was kind of the Formula One car, if you like, of its day. Do you remember the film Ben-Hur?
Oh, four in a line like that.
Yeah, four in a line. And quadriga racing was such a huge deal in Roman times. Closest thing to a chariot race these days, there is one famous race that takes place... Actually, it's twice a year.
The wheelbarrow. All right, but we're not going past my mother's.
It's in Siena. It is the Palio horse race in Siena. It is
they go through the town.
Unbelievably exciting. It's around the central square of this historic city. And it's very like quadriga racing because it is de rigueur for the riders to hinder each other, to bribe the opponents pretty much as they please. The whips, they're made of dried, distended bull's penises. Oh. And they use them not just on the horses, but on each other. And the winner is the first horse over the line, whether or not the jockey has come with him.
Yeah, I always think that would be an interesting take on the Grand National, because quite often a horse, unhampered by a human being, actually wins. And you sort of think, in many ways, we're holding them back, aren't we? Let them run.
All of them look like jockeys, except the guy in the blue in the middle, who looks like he's the victim of a drunken prank. he was on a stag do, and then he's just woken up and gone, shit, I'm on a horse!
there's no saddles, so they're going bareback.
Yeah. It's a bit like the Amish in that they limit the technology they're allowed. They're not allowed the whips. They've got to be bulls' penises. They can't be. I mean,
they've got to dick slap each other.
Also, who makes those whips? Do you mean
the cows?
Yeah. I'm just imagining some old Italian man whittling away at like a big knob until he gets his down.
Well, I do this for a long time, It's my only job. Once a year, I'm important in the town. I make a little dick whips. It's an honest day's living.
That was my Italian accent. Yes, Mr. Wonder.
You're like the sort of the rogue fifth member of the Dolmio family.
Do you think the length of the whips is dependent on the weather?
It depends on how many sexy cows have won.
I dispute the fact that these bulls' penises would still display arousal. Severed and dried. I'm pretty sure mine wouldn't.
We'll never know, David. No. Or perhaps we will.
Mine's barely functioning and it's still attached.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on. We're a lot tamer here. The only people who race around a square in this country are students on foot. You know, like that scene in Chariots of Fire where they race around the square in the middle of the college, you know.
What's
it called? Come on, audience.
Mara.
Quad. Okay.
Quad.
I can't believe you fell for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bad luck, audience. You guys suck.
It's a curiosity about Cambridge. All quadrangles are called courts, apart from the court of Downing College, which is a quad. And the race depicted, that one in Chariots of Fire, it takes place annually around, anybody know which court is it?
Cambridge College.
It's the quad.
The event they're depicting takes place at Trinity College, but they filmed it at Eton.
They did film it at Eton, and a quadrangle at Eton is not called a quad either, it's called a yard.
And these are the people who will one day be in charge of the government. Interesting.
So the real-life race is against the clock. It's a 370-metre course, and they have to get round in the time it takes the clock to strike 12. Depending on when it was last wound, it could be 43, it could be 44 seconds. There used to be a similar tradition that MPs and House of Commons staff would attempt to run across Westminster Bridge at noon during the time it took Big Ben to strike 12. So that's 353 metres. They have to do it in less than 46 seconds. The very first person to do it was a Commons tea room worker called Florence Eilott. Mm. On April the 14th, 1934, she was aged 20. There she is.
Oh, wow.
I love this picture because Big Ben has still got scaffolding. The speed required is, it's only about 17 miles per hour, as opposed to modern championship sprint speed, which is about 28 miles per hour. But she completed the feat with time to spare. She actually made it by the 10th chime. And I'm delighted to tell you that her son and grandson are with us in the audience.
Oh, great! Wow!
So, Scott, it was astonishing because her 400-metre time, it wasn't far off the world record at the time, is that right?
Well, apparently, yeah, we don't really know quite where she started and where she finished, but she was pretty bloody fast by the looks of it.
Mm. And did she just carry on working at the House of Commons, or what happened to her?
She was an amateur runner, that's what she did in her spare time, and she met her future husband, my granddad, his dad, while running. But it was amateur days, of course, so they didn't make any money out of it. They'd win prizes, canteens of cutlery and things like that.
Well, that would be fine on this show, wouldn't it, if you went home with a canteen of cutlery?
Very, very pleased.
This is nothing to do with anything, but you and I have worked together, have we not?
Yes, I was a question setter on 15 to 1.
You set about 2,000 questions for me, you bastard.
OK. Yeah,
Greg and Scott back. Yeah. Now, which do you fancy, being quartered with your grandparents or impaled with your other half? What do you reckon?
Is it a family tree question?
Sort of. Why do you say that?
Well, because you've got four grandparents.
It's to do with heraldry, is the truth of it. Heraldic convention.
So you could, if you're going to create your own symbol, you do it in combination with your other half or with your family.
Exactly that.
But I thought it was going to be something to do with torture. Like, would you like to be quartered with your grandparents? Like a form of old torture, like Game of Thronesies or something like that. Game of Thronesies.
Game of Thronesies.
Game of Thronesies.
That's the one I watch.
You can't pay a attention because you've literally got a giraffe between your
legs. Gorgeous. Just love learning. Oh, turn me on.
Oh my God.
It's nice to watch something happen and go, that's going to be a gif.
So it's a heraldic convention quartering whereby arms inherited from different ancestral lines are combined into a single coat of arms.
It is the one, like in the royal coat of arms, it's divided into quarters.
Well, it implies that it's divided into four. Yeah. But there's no theoretical limit to the number of quarters that you can display. If you have enough what's called armigerous forebears, it is possible to have all of the elements of your family put into one shield. So in the 18th century, the Marquess of Buckingham, he achieved 719 quarters on a single shield. I mean, it looks like a mosaic, doesn't it? It's absolutely
looks like a magic eye picture.
So the four thing that you're talking about, darling, when it's split into four quadrants, they are called quarters, and the arms they contained are called quarterings, but a shield can have as many quarterings as...
You can quarter it and quarter it and quarter it.
As you are entitled to. Yeah. So impalement, which was the other one, is when a married couple's coat of arms are displayed side by side on a single shield. And by convention, the husband's side is the dexter side. Anybody know which side that is? Dexter?
The right.
It is the right, but it is...
From the point of view of the knight?
It's exactly, right, my darling, okay. Yes. Extra point to you. It is entirely on the point of view of the person who is actually holding it. Does anybody know what the one on the right might be? Why might you have one that looks like that?
When you got a couple of wives.
Exactly right.
Is that right?
Yes. Usually one's dead. I'm not saying...
Oh, right.
Two at the same time. First wife goes on top.
Always. Calls the shots.
In the bedroom and the grave.
Yeah.
So did Henry VIII have one with sort of stripes?
Just stripes
on it, yeah.
Stripes all the way through. Yeah.
A couple of heads hanging off it.
The College of Arms have now updated it and they have same-sex married couples' shields as well. It's all a very modern
world. Did it all come from having to show what team in the army you were from? Again, that's probably terminology you're not au fait with, but it's definitely real and right.
OK, well, I have the very person who can answer this question for us. We have in the audience the Clarenceau King of Arms, Patrick Dickinson. Thank you so very much for coming in. Why did it start? Why do we have this?
Oh, actually, it's absolutely right. It's because if knights were in armour and you couldn't see who they were, the shield told you.
Right. And how many are you, the kings of arms?
Three in England, one in Scotland.
Right.
Four altogether.
No, there are people who say this is an extraordinary waste of public funds. Do you mind me asking how much you get paid to be the Clarenceau King of Arms?
And we're not supporting public funds at all.
Fantastic.
We get salaries from the Crown,
right,
which were last increased in 1620. I'm paid £20 25 pence by the Queen, and that is the level to which it was reduced by William IV in the 1830s.
You haven't had a pay rise since?
No, not since the 1830s.
What's like your daily, like, do you get up, have your coffee, check your emails, put on your arms? Like, what's your daily like?
Then do I put on all that kit?
Yeah.
No, I set about designing coats of arms, tracing family trees, that sort of thing.
What's the weirdest thing you've had as a request?
There's a urinal on a 16, but a urinal in the sense of a doctor's flask. Oh, and footballs have appeared. I put one in Elton John's coat of arms.
That's fantastic.
Yep.
It is a real honour to have had the Clarenceau King of Arms here.
Yay!
Now, since we're talking about quads and quins, here's a question on multiple births. What's the best way to avoid paying income tax in Hungary? Bob!
Don't work in Hungary.
I think that's fair. Yeah. Mm.
It is, in general, the most fail-safe way of avoiding income tax.
Mm-hmm.
Avoid income.
Yeah. Look at that building, isn't it stunning? It's the Parliament in Budapest. But the quickest way, at present, to achieve income tax exemption is to have quadruplets.
What?
I know. So, February 2019, the Prime Minister, Viktor Orban, announced that women who have four or more children will be permanently exempted from income tax. Why might he decide to do this?
I feel like there's probably a not particularly fun answer to this, that it's about getting more and more Hungarians.
It's about immigration.
They don't want immigrants.
They don't want immigrants,
and they're trying to repopulate with real Hungarians. Isn't that a thing?
It's essentially encouraging breeding as an act of racism.
Yes, exactly. I don't think if I moved to Hungary and managed to produce four kids...
He'd be thrilled.
He wouldn't be delighted.
No. So while we're on the subject, what was the Toronto Stork Derby?
Is it a race with storks delivering babies?
Yes, yes. So, this was a multi-birth contest in Ontario. 1936. It was described by the province's Premier Mitchell Hepburn as the most revolting and disgusting exhibition ever put on in a civilised country. What happened was there was a great guy, I think, called Charles Miller. He was a lawyer, he was a financier, mm-hmm. he was a practical joker, and he had nobody to leave his money to. And so he stated in his will that whoever could have the most babies in 10 years could have his money.
Grim.
Yep. It attracted a huge amount of interest because some of his investments made a lot of money. It was a huge fortune. His $100,000 estate turned into a $750,000 fortune by the end of the race. And mothers went crazy.
You only have 10 max, though, surely, or like 10 and one on the way.
No, if you have multiples, if you have twins.
You could have sextuplets 10 times. You could have 60.
Oh, right.
So that woman, who looks frankly exhausted, was one of the contestants. She had 13 children. Five women had 56 babies between them. We don't know how many of those were multiple births. And in the end, the pot was eventually split four ways with two consolation prizes for women who had been disqualified.
Women who'd been disqualified?
What did they get disqualified for?
Maybe they'd adopted.
Borrowed that would babies.
I've adopted 700.
Some of the babies were illegitimate and so disqualified.
What?
Yeah, that's harsh.
He was a great prankster, Charles Miller. He left brewery shares to a prohibitionist campaigning group on condition that they actually ran the business. Racecourse shares to anti-gambling clerics. And he left a holiday home in Jamaica to three men who hated each other on condition they all lived in it together indefinitely. Sounds like a great sitcom, doesn't it? The Toronto Stork Derby, the most disgusting exhibition ever. Mm. Well, until now. It's time for general ignorance. What's your normal temperature?
Isn't it lower if you're a woman than a man?
Slightly higher for a woman.
Slightly higher.
Yeah, it was one or the other, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Just go either way with that.
Because, you know, there's that stereotype of, like, turn up the heating, but I'm too hot, babes!
It is an issue that office temperatures are set to male averages as opposed to female averages.
Do you know a fact about Christine Lagarde, who's the head
I don't know any IMF. Facts about Christine Lagarde.
Oh, well, you're about to bloody get one, Sandy. Let's swap chairs! Have your glasses for a second.
Yeah, okay. Do you want some cards?
Yeah.
Oh, no, that's got all the answers on there.
Of course, the interesting thing about Christine Lagarde that she used to do was that she... please stop laughing, darling. I'm trying to get through the fact. she, when she'd go into business meetings, would put on a lot of layers for the meeting and turn down the heating so it'd be freezing cold and they'd all be shivering so they'd make a deal quicker.
Is that true?
Yes, or sometimes she'd turn up the heating really hot and she'd come in like a small dress. And the men would get really sweaty, and then they'd try and hurry through.
I love that about her.
Thank you very much.
That's fantastic.
That's a little bit.
So, what do we reckon? Normal body temperature, you know.
97.6. That's not what I said.
Oh, no.
It has often been said 98.6 is a sort of normal temperature.
I got it wrong, of course.
97.6 is most recently dead.
It turns out there's no single value for normal. There was a study in 1868 by a German doctor with the wonderful name of Karl Reinhold August Wunderlich. He had a thermometer that was a foot long. He put it under people's armpits and it took 20...
Oh, thank God.
I know. It It took 20 minutes to actually assess what the temperature was. And it turns out the thermometer, which has been recently retested, had been calibrated wrong. And it ran about 3 degrees higher in Fahrenheit than a modern thermometer. Mm. And the fact that he took it under the arm, which produces readings that are lower and less reliable than temperatures taken orally. So he was working with errors in both directions, basically. It's no wonder he settled entirely on the wrong answer.
So there he is. There is a picture of an idiot.
Well, actually, you were inadvertently, possibly, closest. The average actually comes out at about 97.7. And you said 97.6. So I think you should get another point for that. That's very good. Now, here's the easiest question ever. What city are we looking at here?
Westminster.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very good.
Highlighted things, the city of Westminster. There's also another city in London. What is the other city in London?
London.
It is the city of London, so the...
Yes!
Yes. Wow, it's good to be that excited. We have the city of London, which is the financial district, but Greater London is actually a ceremonial county rather than a city, and so the conurbation which we call London, it contains two cities. It is not itself officially a city. What is the difference, however, between a city and a town?
Well, it used to be that cities had cathedrals. There's somebody, obviously, in the gallery can't hear the phrase, it used to be.
The city has a multiplex and a Nando's.
It's a purely honorific thing. It's granted by the sovereign by letters patent, and it has nothing to do with whether you have a cathedral. There are now 18 cities without a cathedral. There are 16 towns that have cathedrals but are not cities. And lastly, here's a quadrilateral. Is this shape A square, a rectangle and an oblong, or B, a square and a rectangle but not an oblong, or C, an oblong and a square but not a rectangle, or D, a triangle?
Who's whispering in the audience?
B.
She sounds like she knows.
Yeah, you like that? Yeah. Goes with your surname, you want to go with it?
Yeah. Ashling, B, please.
B, please, is absolutely right. Well done to the audience.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. A rectangle is defined as a quadrilateral with four right angles, and a square complies with that definition. So a square is a rectangle. I mean, it's a special kind of rectangle. It has four sides of the same length. But an oblong is defined as a rectangle which is specifically not a square. So the square in our picture is a square and a rectangle, but not an oblong. Well, I think, strictly speaking, that point ought to go to the audience.
Yeah.
Which brings me to the quinquaddly business of the scores. Let's see what kind of shape they are in. In first place, the winner, fair and square, with minus four, is David. In second place, with minus five, Alan. In third place, with minus seven, Ashley.
Yeah.
In fourth place, with minus eight, the audience. Last place, I'm afraid. It's back to square one with minus 18. Nish! that exhausts the possibilities of quads and quins for tonight, so it's thanks to Ashling, Nish, David and Alan. And I leave you with this quote about quads. In 1851, Charles Calverley was showing some visitors around Balliol College, Oxford. This is Balliol College, he announced, as he led them through the front quad. This is the master's lodgings, he continued, waving at the building. He then bent down, picked a stone from the path and hurled it through a nearby window. And that, he said, pointing to the man screaming at them through the shattered glass, is the master himself. Good night.